Hachette Audio presents The President Will See You Now, My Stories and Lessons from Ronald Reagan's Final Years, written and read by the author, Peggy Grande. Includes a Mac and PC-compatible PDF of bonus material. Dedication. This book is dedicated to everyone who has ever wondered, so what was Ronald Reagan really like? For his admirers, I hope this will add a new dimension to your respect. He was a true giant among greats. For those who don't know much about him, may you get to know him as a person, respect him as a gentleman, and perhaps even develop a fondness for him by listening to this book. Whether or not you met Ronald Reagan in person during his lifetime, it's time for you to meet him now, and I'm happy to introduce you. The President Will See You Now. Prologue. March 6, 2016. As the jet banked over Los Angeles International Airport, I felt happy to be coming home after an exhausting two-week, three-state business trip. When the plane was wheels down, I instinctively switched on my phone and it vibrated so frantically, I feared it was broken. A steady stream of text messages and emails scrolled past, one at a time, not stopping long enough for me to read each in full. They continued one after the other, dozens of emails and nearly 100 text messages. My pulse was racing as I caught key words and phrases that jumped off the screen. "Peggy, you must be heartbroken. My thoughts are with you. I'm sorry for your loss. The world will never see another First Lady like her. She will be missed." I put the phone down for a second to absorb the news. Mrs. Reagan had passed away while I was in the air. I had anticipated this day for years, but that did not lessen my shock and sorrow now that it had arrived. At that moment, as the plane taxied to the terminal, I was transported back to that first day 27 years ago. I had been a young woman still in college when I joined the president's staff. This was my dream job, one I had held for a decade, from just a few months after he left the White House until he withdrew from public life. The experience transformed my life. Although it had been 17 years since I worked for him full-time, my response to the news was automatic. I knew I would be going from the airport directly into action to do whatever the former First Family needed from me. My phone rang and I startled. "Peggy, where have you been?" asked a former Office of Ronald Reagan colleague. "We've been trying to reach you for hours." "My plane just landed," I said, gathering my things as quickly as I could. "I'm still on the plane. I can't really talk, but I can listen. What do you need me to do?" "We need you to go straight to Gates Kingsley and Gates Moeller Murphy Funeral Home in Santa Monica. A Secret Service agent just arrived there. We will meet you there in about an hour." "I'm on my way." The people who had emailed, called, and texted me while I was in the air were colleagues in the years I worked for the Reagans, people who knew of my close personal connection and friends who I knew would step back into action professionally, but also would be personally grieving. They all assumed that I already knew. I was always in the know. Yet this was not like when President Reagan passed away and I was among the first to hear before it was released publicly. This time I felt as if I was the last to hear. It was devastating both ways. Knowing how quickly Reagan staffers leap into action, I assumed that the previously established funeral arrangements were well underway and I would need to jump in with both feet at full speed. Every death results in a wave of decisions and tasks that can overwhelm friends and family members. In the case of a former First Lady, the additional layers of logistics and complexity are enormous. Implementation would require an army, yet, as I would discover, none would manifest. A few dozen dedicated people would do as I had done, walk away from their lives, families, and other commitments to ensure that Mrs. Reagan was properly laid to rest and would be remembered in a way that was fitting. As I waited for the other passengers to disembark the plane, I took out two stapled sheets of paper, folded neatly into eighths, that I had carefully and purposefully tucked into a secure pocket of my purse. I had transferred that now dog-eared document from purse to purse for 3 years, since my role in the plan for the First Lady's funeral was last updated. My husband Greg often teases me about my perpetual and perhaps compulsive state of readiness, but small things like this are part of my routine so that I'm always prepared for a day just like the one that stretched before me. I unfolded the paper carefully, knowing that the creases made it fragile. On it was a list of people I had been assigned to call the moment that I knew Mrs. Reagan had died. As I walked through the airport to the baggage claim, I started making those calls. The names on the list were people I knew well, part of the core group. We all had the honor of serving the Reagans, a high point in our lives. We were proud to be associated with them and were very much a family. There were a few people on my list who had preceded me working for the Reagans, and a few who stayed on after I left. We had shared a unique experience, and now, this loss. As I glanced down the list, I pictured the president's stately offices in Century City and remembered the awestruck young woman who had arrived for a job interview 27 years earlier. Many of the people I was about to call had helped guide me in my journey from naive college student to someone who was comfortable in the world of motorcades and private jets and could remain composed when surrounded by some of the most famous people on earth. I knew when I called I'd be catching some of them in airports on their way to Los Angeles. All of us, the moment that we heard, would clear the week ahead to do what we could to ensure that everything came off perfectly, pulling together for one final event, our last time to collaborate as a fine-tuned machine. Waiting at baggage claim, I thought of the last time I saw Mrs. Reagan, right before Christmas, visiting with the kids as we always did at the holidays. She was in her signature red, wearing a beautiful cashmere sweater, and had pulled up close to me, practically nose to nose, holding my arm as we spoke as if she wanted to be able to see me and hear me and be reminded again of all that we had shared, because most of what we had shared involved her husband. I remember her looking intently at me as we reminisced about her beloved Ronnie. I told her again of my fondness for him and for her and how I still missed him. She said she did too. We all do, but her most of all. Things were never the same since he left us, and never would be. She was gracious and hospitable, but I was afraid of staying too long as she seemed tired. I didn't want to leave, though, not knowing when the next time was that I would see her. And I feared that I might not again. Bag wheeling behind me, my heavy heart leapt when I came out of the terminal and saw my husband Greg with two of our four children idling in our car at the curb in front of the baggage claim door. After 25 years of marriage, Greg knew what he needed to do as soon as he heard that Mrs. Reagan had died. He canceled my car service, loaded the girls into the family car, and headed for the airport. He knew I would not be going home until late that night and that the family would not be seeing much of me for the rest of that week. My family got out of the car to greet me. Greg gave me a long and comforting hug, and sweet embraces from my two youngest daughters followed. I hopped in the front seat and reached back to touch the hands of my girls. The First Lady had been a big presence in their lives, and I knew they, too, were feeling this loss. "Where to?" Greg asked. "Kingsley Gates in Santa Monica, 20th in Arizona," I said. "Can we stop and get something for me to eat later? And I have to change my clothes." It was game day. We stopped at a nearby supermarket where the girls dashed in to buy me snacks and a sandwich. In the front seat, with Greg shielding me from passersby, I wiggled into a dress I had retrieved from my suitcase, changed back into heels, adding jewelry and a spritz of perfume. I smoothed a few wrinkles out of the dress, checked my makeup in the visor mirror, and was reapplying my lipstick when the girls returned. Within a few minutes, we were at the funeral home. This was the same mortuary that had received the president's body 12 years earlier. And the physical sensation of grief from that memory washed over me as I entered the foyer. Right now, though, I had to put aside those feelings to focus. The specifics had not been assigned or defined, but a mental checklist immediately emerged as I introduced myself to the Secret Service agent who was waiting there. I dove into the details. We did a quick walkthrough to determine where the public would stand to observe and where they could place flowers. We chose spots for the media trucks that would broadcast live the arrival of the First Lady's body, established locations for stand-up live shots, and marked off a place from which the cameras could capture the arrival of the hearse. The hearse soon arrived. As employees of the funeral home gingerly unloaded the simple pewter-colored casket that held Mrs. Reagan's body, I greeted the staffers who had arrived with the motorcade. They were people I hadn't seen for a while and would have enjoyed reuniting with under different circumstances. Yet I knew them so well and had worked with them for so many years that we did not even need to speak. We all understood our collective mission at that moment. Instinctively, we moved in unison, silently, to protect her, as we had always done together in the past. We placed ourselves in a line to block some of the view of her casket from the media and the watching public. From that Sunday of her passing through Wednesday, when the First Lady's body was transferred to the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library in Simi Valley, I was stationed at the funeral home, helping to coordinate both the big, complex logistics and the small, simple ones of her funeral, from choreographing the departure ceremony to confirming who rides in which limousine in the motorcade. These were among the thousands of details we as a team arranged to ensure the world could grieve without the distraction of mishaps. On
Wednesday, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.